I want to welcome everybody here this morning. My name's Claude Graves. I'm the president of Collin County Rose Society and one of the founders of an organization we call the Rose Rosette Eradication Alliance. Eradication being a somewhat hopeful word, but we felt like that was our bottom line goal and why not go for it. This is a group of cities, businesses, and agencies that all have a common interest in trying to see Rose Rosette brought under control in this area so we can continue to grow beautiful roses. And we've had, this is the third in the series of programs that we've had on Rose Rosette. The first two have dealt pretty much with what it is. And to a certain extent, those have been kind of depressing programs. And today I want to tell you, we're going to offer you some hope for the future, that maybe there is a way out of this and a way that we can grow roses again. We got two speakers today, both of which have had an extensive amount of interest and experience with dealing with Rose Rosette in garden situations. They're going to address what they're doing and some things that we'll be doing in the future that can help us manage our gardens to where we can continue to grow roses and minimize losses from Rose Rosette disease. The first is Dr. Mark Windham from the University of Tennessee. He's an ornamental plant pathologist. He's done a lot of research on foliar diseases of roses and has been battling Rose Rosette disease for 20 years in Tennessee. They've had that problem much longer than we have. I won't go any further. I'll turn it over to Mark and let him tell you what he wants to tell you. Thank you.
We're going to get started. Hope. I'm an optimistic person by training. I mean, when you're a plant pathologist, it's all doom and gloom. Nobody comes to me to look for at pictures or pretty plants. So to stay sane, you better be optimistic. Otherwise, you wear a black robe and you carry a sickle. And I try not to do that. But why best management practices are needed? As you have found out here, Rose Rosette disease, if left unchecked, will destroy roses. These pictures are from Murfreesboro, Tennessee. They were made not that long ago at a new strip mall, and you can see what the roses look like in 2011. That picture really does not do the roses justice. That bed is over 100 yards long. And so you can see what it looked like in 2012 and then what it looked like in 2014. So left unchecked, Rose Rosette can certainly ruin your day as far as roses go. But one of the first things that I want to point out is beware the internet. The internet has all kind of things on it, and there's a lot of things on it about Rose Rosette. The picture you're looking at, I took from the internet, of genetically modified organisms that have become a secret weapon of the U.S. Navy. I believe it. But the point is that beware of websites that they say the way to control Rose Rosette is to buy their product. That's a first giveaway. Even some university websites will have things where I will call them and say, where did you learn this? And they say, well, it's our best guess. And I don't like best guesses. I'm a little retentive on hard data. And so all I can say is beware of what you see. So where can you go to get good information? There is good information. Not everybody is into social media, but I would dare say there's many of you in this room who are. And one of the best places at the moment to go, if you do Facebook, is the Combating Rose Rosette page. This is something that Dave Byrne posted on that webpage on April 5th of this month. And if you like it, if something new about Rose Rosette is found, it's probably going to appear here first. In which case, then, if you have liked the page, anytime something new pops up on the page, you're notified of that. And so, but there's other types of things. There's a website that's being developed. The American Nursery Association also has a website on Rose Rosette. And so there are places where you can go to get reliable information. That's probably the first step towards a best management practice plan, is to make sure that you're getting reliable information. That is absolutely critical. Another thing that is critical is that you have to understand what we're up against. You have to understand the virus. You don't have to understand it on the level that Ioannis Xanatakis understands it, but we have to understand, we have to know some things about the virus, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. And we also have to know some things about how it spreads, which is most commonly through a particular aerified mite. But for 70 years we had wondered, it was a virus, and then it wasn't a virus, and then it was something called a molecule or a phytoplasm, and then it was a virus again. And you know, even plant pathologists were shaking their heads, and nobody wanted to work with this because it was hard, and we didn't know exactly what caused it. Well, Almer and Ioannis, they put that to bed in 2011, and we'll be always grateful to them for doing so. What does Rose Rosette look like? We were looking at some Rose Rosette just a few minutes ago out front. If you really want to see it, go to the Holiday Inn Express where I'm staying, and it's magnificent there. Remember, I'm a pathologist. But to begin with, there are three symptoms that I have learned to look for. I don't look in your bottom right, the big rosettes. I don't look for those. What I look for is thin, what I call strapped foliage. That means it's unusually thinned, will be a little bit distorted. There will be increased thorniness towards the terminals of those stems, and the stems will begin to thicken and perhaps even flatten. And one of those symptoms, and I just sit there and say, you are a bit of an oddball, okay? But then I will watch it in the future. But if I get two symptoms, all my alarms in my heads are going off, and if I see all three, well, it's there it is. And so those are the types of things. But you do get the witch's brooms. You do get distorted flower buds, and you do get plant death. All those things occur. But the concentration of symptoms that we need to be concerned about are those first three. And we'll talk more about why in just a minute. But why is it lethal to roses? Well, in 1983, North Carolina State University, which is a wonderful place, made a mistake and gave me a PhD in virology. And when I left there, I thought, I will never work with viruses again. I have learned my lesson. I'm going to work with something that I can see. But there are many different mechanisms by which viruses kill plants, and we don't need to go into those today. But there are end results of those. And Dr. James/Jim Amrine, who's retired from West Virginia University and who, in my opinion, is the encyclopedia of Rose Rosette and this particular aerified mite, found many years ago that in roses that were symptomatic for Rose Rosette, that the end result of the mechanisms of the virus in the plant is that there's no starch accumulation in the roots during the summer and the fall. Which means what? The plants have a very difficult time overwintering. So they go into the winter with very symptomatic, and if you have a harsh winter, which I understand you did not have here this past winter, for next year you see lots of dead branches, You may have whole dead plants. And this is really what is causing the lethal part of this disease, which is the lack of starch accumulation in the roots. Phyllocoptus fructophyllus is the aerified mite. It's windborne, but it does not fly. When I was a little boy, back in the 1950s and early 60s, those opaque window shades were all in vogue to keep light from coming in early in the morning. And, you know, we would poke, when Mama wasn't looking, we would poke pinholes in those shades, because during the day where the sunbeam came through those shades, you could watch dust particles float in and out. Those dust particles are approximately the same size of these mites. You will not see them with a magnifying glass. You will not see them with one of those little loops. They're too small. So they're very, very tiny. And how long have we known about these mites on roses? The first report of them was back in the 1930s, but they were known out there before that. But this is what it looks like. The picture in the background was taken by Baldo Vegas. He's a retired state entomologist from California. And then more recently, some USDA scientists have taken SEM pictures of them, and that's the gray thing. And so you can see these tiny things. That magnification in the background was made at 80x. Okay, so a strong little loop, which is much stronger than a magnifying glass, is about 10x. So this has to be about 8 times, and you can still see how tiny they are. But they're big enough for us to see and for us to count. And so this is what we're up against. As you can see, no wings. They call it ballooning. It's sort of, they just float in the air. So where your wind currents, directions of winds, things like that are very important in the spread of this disease, because where the wind blows them, they will go. Of course, not all aerified mites on roses, practically all roses have some, are carrying this virus. So just because somebody detects aerified mites on a plant does not mean that that plant is going to become infected with the virus. I'm sure in the grand scheme of things, if we could figure out how to do that type of study, we'd find that the percentage carrying it is actually quite small, but it's obviously significant. Okay, where can Rose Rosette hide? It hides in a lot of places. Multiflora rose is one place that it hides. Multiflora rose is very susceptible. The virus is lethal in multiflora rose, but you cannot get rid of multiflora rose. Dr. M. Wine explained to us several years ago that a mature multiflora rose will produce approximately 250,000 seed a year. Those seed can lay dormant on the ground for at least a decade, maybe more. So that if a plant dies from Rose Rosette, sunlight gets to the ground, new plants spring up, and before the virus can kill them, they will have already reseeded. So this is not something that can be used as a biological control agent for multiflora rose. Where else does it hide? I have seen it in retail and wholesale nurseries. I've seen it in club sales. I once saw it in a door prize at a Rose Society. And then I had a major deliverance. What did I do? It was the only door prize they had. And so did I tell them, or did I just let it go? You know, I won't tell you what I did, but I'll let you sit there and wonder what you would do. But that happens. Another place that it hides is in commercial or public plantings. This is a picture that was taken this year, wintertime, in South Carolina, in Columbia, South Carolina, right across from the state capitol building. The roses was the rose, the fairy. And this is one of two beds. The incidence of Rose Rosette was 100%. Now, they come in and plant some more roses nearby, and what do you think is going to happen? You know, the mites are going, when the wind is right, the mites are going to balloon in from these bushes into those. And so commercial public plantings. I like to tell people that if you live out in the middle of nowhere, which here in Allen, it may have been nowhere at one time, but this is definitely somewhere now. If you live, though, out in the country, you might be cursing multiflora rose. But if you live in an urban area, probably it's commercial plantings is where the mites carrying the virus are coming from. So these types of things are very, very important to understand. And then in Tennessee, the largest retail nursery, they sell approximately 900 roses a year. They had a bed of drift roses out front, and I found Rose Rosette in it last year. And their roses for sale were less than 200 feet away. Okay. Now, since I found it, that bush was destroyed. And they watched the other ones, and no more plants became symptomatic. But what if I hadn't found it? It would have spread to those other drift roses, and then it would have spread, and they would have been selling asymptomatic roses to people who would have carried them home, and then Rose Rosette, little miniature epidemics would have started where they were at. So it's important when you are putting a best management plan together that you understand the epidemiology / the ecology and how the vector and the virus work. It's critical to be able to do that. I wanted just to make a mention. We do not know that knockout roses, they get a bum rap in my opinion, that they are any more susceptible to Rose Rosette than any other rose out there. We're probably going to know that in a couple of years or less, but we don't know that now. What I like to tell people is that in Knoxville, if you walk into a high school, approximately 80 to 85% of the students, male and female, in that high school are going to have brown to black hair. They will be known as brunettes. Okay, brown to black hair. If a new cold virus sweeps through that school and everybody's sick, can't you just see it on the news? There appears to be a correlation between brown and black hair and being susceptible to this virus because so many kids with brown and black hair have it. Okay, most of the commercial plantings that we see do have knockout in their name, but that doesn't mean they're any more susceptible. Those fairies that you saw, the incidence was 100%. You see, what they have in common is that they're very, very low maintenance roses. And so when the landscape company puts the bid in, they put the bid in, perhaps to prune them a little bit in the spring, maybe put some more mulch down, check them once or twice during the summer for big weeds, and that's the end of it. Where we can't do that with Rose Rosette management. We have to be much more vigilant than that. And that's why these things the virus tends to run amok in them. It's not to increase susceptibility. I hear people say, I won't grow knockouts, they're too susceptible. And I sit there staring at them going, well, just what are you going to grow? Dave Byrne needs to know if you have one that is resistant, because we don't know of any resistance. And so I just want you to understand that miniature roses, on the other hand, it's very rare that I hear of one. But they're small, they're tiny. Proportionally, they're not intercepting very many mites. And I really and truly think that's the only difference between them and a knockout. Knockout's a big thing like me. Dust blows through this room. The odds are I'm going to intercept a lot. Dave Burns is thin. He won't intercept as many. If he was short, he would intercept even fewer. So that is that. I mentioned constant vigilance. One of the things that we tell people is that they've got to be observant. Because if you're not observant, things will go bad quickly. You see the leopard? Okay, he's there. Just waiting to pounce on you when you walk by. Okay? But if you weren't constantly vigilant and observant, you'd be dead. It's just that simple. Okay. If he was hungry. And, you know, my wife just thinks he's a cat, but I think he's deadly. The same thing happens in roses. Wherever you have a small rose garden of your own, you manage commercial plantings, you manage a rose garden. Here is a commercial planting. There's the only bush that's infected at that time. if you don't catch that, if you don't catch that before mites start ballooning to other bushes, you're going to be in trouble. But we can catch it. We can stop it. And by doing so, we may be able to enjoy that rose bed on the way to the Nashville airport for many, many years. See, a nice thing about knockouts is, even if we took out 20% of those bushes over time, the other ones would just grow into the space, and the public would never know that it had even happened. So these kind of things can be managed. When to catch rose rosette? Well, there's the action stage. You know, it takes practice. That's why I wanted to go look at the roses out there. I cannot look at enough rose bushes that have the beginning symptoms of rose rosette. And I have looked at thousands, and I want to look at tens of thousands more, because every time I do, I get a little bit better. And this one over here, thickened stems, the one over on your right, thickened stems, increased thorniness, strapped leaves. The action stage has two of those symptoms. Look at this guy, it's almost too late. And when you get to these kind of stages, you're behind the eight ball. By now, if you're in midsummer, I mean certainly late summer, there's probably ballooning viliferous, that means they carry the virus, mites, blowing to other plants. And so and you most likely have unsymptomatic infected plants around those and downwind from them. So the key is to stay out from behind the eight ball. That is one of the keys. Another thing is that if you're removing sick plants, make sure you get all the roots where they were, for so sprouts won't come back. Because then the sprouts do come back if it's an infected plant. My God, you just want to put a gun to their head and shoot them. I mean, they just look terrible. And, you know, and I don't know if plants suffer or not. That's for somebody else. And no, I do not hug plants, especially roses. They have prickers or / thorns. But the bottom line is, these things will sprout back. They may not have mites on them. And no one has done the study yet or not. I don't think mites have attractants like aphids. Aphids fly, mites float. So they're just sort of landing. But there's no doubt that eventually mites will be on those bushes, and then they will balloon, or their progeny will, and they will carry the virus from those plants once again. Well, real quickly now, we've gone through that, and to be honest with you, that was the important part. The rest of this is just what we found out. It started a number of years ago with the University of Tennessee and American Rose Society. They took a risk on me, and I took a risk on them. I really didn't want to work with Rose Rosette, mainly because I considered it something that was really, really hard. And my deans like things that are fast and papers come out quick and that kind of thing. And I was looking at this going, "Ee," you know. But we did it. The mites, we wondered if we could intercept them, and that at home. Where I lived, there's no doubt that where I live, that the winds predominantly in the heat of summer and into the fall blow from one specific direction. So I had rosette, and I had wondered, and I had noticed that it seemed to start and then blow downwind. So I had wondered if I could stop it with a barrier, and so we used a fast-growing cultivar, Miscanthus sinensis. And you can't use this everywhere because in some places this type of thing is invasive. But it's not on the plateau and up Tennessee and where we did the work. And so we had plots that had barriers, and we had to put them all the way around because this was a completely random design. So there could be roses without barriers on any side of them. And so we had to put the grass all the way around them. And it didn't stop it, but what we found was, but can you slow it down coming into our garden? And is it statistically significant? Yes. But we can't stop. We can't stop it, but we can slow it down. So barriers may, if you have that type of setup, it may be useful. Another thing that we looked at were miticides. And we didn't have a lot of space for miticides then, and this wasn't a lot of money. And but we looked at some things, and we had, and you say, well, gosh, Doc, why did you choose those? We had a board of advisors of 8 rosarians from different rose societies and rose districts in the southeast. They helped choose them. You know, if you're going to have an advisory board, by God, you got to use them. You know, and you can't just sit there and roll your eyes. And so we did use them, and we also talked to entomologists as well. But what we found was that 4 of those miticide treatments, where we had used those things for 4 years, not a single plant ever developed rosette, whereas all the controls developed rosette, and the 7 treatments developed rosette, and the horticultural oil treatments, 6 out of 8 of them developed rosette, but none of these ever got rosette. And so you're sitting there looking at those going, well, now this may have some use. But now here's another problem. How many of these things carry a homeowner's label? Well, we're working on that. Okay, we think we're going to be able to do that, and with a couple of them. But then there's the caveat. Back in 1968, a paper was published that said that if you eliminate spider mites, that aerified mite populations go up. So we have to be careful with miticides, because they may be working for us and working against us at the same time. Because aerified mites do have predators, and some of these predators are different species of spider mites. And so, you know, this is something, this is some of the things that we have to be watchful and careful of as well. And you say, okay, you wrote down, Pam wrote down the 4 miticides, I know she did, okay. But here's what we did. We didn't have space, resources, to stagger when we started. We didn't have money and labor to do the mite counts like we would have liked to have. We didn't know when to quit spraying in the fall, and we didn't know what the spray interval should be. But I only had 1 shot, so we started May 1st and went to 2 weeks after Labor Day arbitrarily, and we sprayed every 2 weeks. So we don't know if we oversprayed, if we had to use that much miticide. We don't know. We don't know if some miticides we don't have to use as often as others. We don't know if there are other effective miticides that we didn't try. And we don't know when we should quit spraying. We obviously quit spraying late enough, but could we have quit spraying earlier? We don't know. So what I'd like to tell people now is that miticides work, but we're using a very dull flint knife and we need a scalpel. So there's a lot of research that still needs to be done to determine how much miticide to use, how often to use, and so we don't overuse it, because if we overuse it, there's always the chance that we could develop less sensitivity to the miticides by the mites if we overuse them. So we have to be cautious as to what we're doing. So I have presented those miticides to you, but we have a long road to go before we sleep as far as miticide work goes. Pruning. The rosarians wanted us to look at pruning. Well, if you catch it at that very earliest stage, you have a 70% chance of stopping it. You will never see that in print by the University of Tennessee, and you won't see it by Texas A&M. And why? Because none of us are going to write something up that doesn't work 30% of the time. I want you to think about that. You know, students taking stats, they tell you 0.05, 5% of the chance of an error. How about an error rate of 30%? You walk to your major professor and tell him that, what's Dave going to say to you? Go get away. Okay, is what he's going to say. Make you get up at 3:30 in the morning to come here. Okay, things like that. But the whole point is 30% failure rate. That's why it'll work for one person and not work for another. Now, you let that symptom sit there for 6 weeks and you try it, and your success rate drops to below 30%, drops to 27%. So you see how important it is to get. So if it's your grandmother's rose that she loved all her life, if you can catch it early, you got a fighting chance. But that's all you've got. And then you got to watch it hard for at least a year. Now, I manage the Beall Family Rose Garden at UT. Why? I'm not sure. But I'd love to give it up. This is why I don't have roses at home anymore. I have these, besides my research roses. But here, I understand now how the Pharaoh built the pyramids. He had all that labor. You know, I have students, and so I understand that better now. But we use roguing, and it is a highly intensive thing. And so what we do is that I have two rose interns, and they only have 275 rose bushes. And every morning, they inspect for rose rosette symptoms. If they see it, the first thing they're going to do, we have got some heavy gauge bags that look like body bags. We had to get them online. They're just garbage bags, but they're really big, and they will drape it all the way over the plant, because Dr. Amwine told us that when we cut that plant off, it might start falling off of it quickly. And we did not want them dragging those plants through the other roses with mites dropping off of them. That's a really bad thing to do. So we drape the bag over them, cut it off, and then we get the bag out, and then they go back and dig the hole up, and 7 days later, because Jim also told us that the mite can only survive off a rose bush for 5 days, but that's hard to remember. A week's easy, because that's the number one, and so 1 week later, we can drop another plant back in that hole. And we've done that, and so far, not one plant that we have replaced has become symptomatic. So it seems to work. So that bore that you read that it's on in the soil and you have to dig up 2 bushels of soil, you see that on the web? No. That's what the shark and the velociraptor and the missile launcher. Okay. So, but the kids sometimes dig up things that aren't rose rosette, and that's okay. They never get fussed at about that. We replace 4 to 5% of the roses each year to keep the garden fresh. Rose rosette takes approximately 3%, 2 to 4% out each year when we catch it early. We're not allowing it to spread to other bushes. Well, you know, when it blows in by random chance, lands on one plant, and an infection occurs, we stop it quick, and we get it out. And by doing that, the public is oblivious to us having a problem. And that's really what it's all about. And so can we do it? Yes, we can. Now, I don't know at this age group if any of you ever saw the Harry Potter movies, but Mad-Eye Moody is constantly yelling constant vigilance, and for very bad guys. But it works, and my students have all seen these movies. So when I mention Mad-Eye Moody to them and say we have to be constantly vigilant, no matter what you're doing, you're watching for Rose Rosette, they get it, and they are. So it works. So, constant vigilance is very, very important. Roguing by itself can be an effective strategy. A green barrier, if you have a small garden, it may work. And I learned last night from Claude that it has worked here in Texas as well. Miticides are going to be useful. Some people have been using them, and they've chosen wisely because they have worked in some cases. Pruning is a crapshoot. If you catch it very, very early, you've got about a 70% chance. If you catch it later than that, it drops to less than 30. So it's a crapshoot. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, okay. Last year, when I first found out about this rose rosette, I noticed one of my rose bushes had it, and then I couldn't really almost down to nothing. And so it's coming back again this year, and it's looking a little symptomatic. Do I have another chance?
What you need to do is to take a shovel and shovel prune that bush. Okay, you need to rogue it. Okay, if it comes back where you pruned it, that's it. One chance and you're gone.
Oh, it's one chance.
You are gone. Okay. Before we go, I'm sure you're in Texas, so you've heard about the new Rose Rosette project. Dave is my boss. When he calls or emails me, he may not think so, but I pay attention. I don't pay attention to my deans. I do pay attention to him. There are 18 co-PIs. We're a very diverse group. God, there's even economists in this group, and I have no idea what they do. But I'm sure what they do is very important, and I'm sure Dave's quite excited about it. I just don't. I've read that part of the proposal several times, and I still have no clue. But these are just some of the things that are in it. There are people working on early detection methods where you don't have to rely on the eyeball. That'll be easy to do. I am waiting for a pregnancy test type thing to come out. I think it will happen. You know, where a little line appears, the test work, the second line appears, you're either pregnant or you have Rose Rosette. And so we're anxious to see that. Best management practices, epidemiology, we know about. Resistant studies, the holy grail, resistant roses. Now, there's a lot of efforts in that. There's the economics, have no idea. And then outreach, like what's happening today or things with this. This is where I'm at. That doesn't mean much to you, but this is about 3.5 acres, fixing to become closer to 4 because we got more plants to put in. The fences are mold. We have 10-foot deer fences, and we've got real. An army may can move their camp quickly, but I guarantee you we can move these fences. You know, and we've had to move them already, and we'll move them again. And this is what we looked like last year when we planted Dave's stuff. And you know, and where is this at? It's on experiment station land, but it's not on any experiment station. It's isolated, can't be seen by the road. And we tried to choose a location where there was nobody with a house nearby growing roses. And they didn't want this on the station because there are roses for other stuff on the station, and we did not want to interfere with other people's work. That's why Dave doesn't want to do this at Texas A&M. Because it would be bad. So I mentioned real quickly the Holy Grail, resistant roses. Here are two that perhaps have resistance to either the virus or the mite. I'm not from Missouri, but I look at them and say, show me. Okay, and we will know. We will know. We will find this out. And if they are, well, then breeders take over and do whatever breeders do. But three things before I go to keep this in perspective. There will be ways, there are ways to manage Rose Rosette disease until resistance is available. That's important. It's also important to keep Rose Rosette in perspective as well. I had a person call me last week who was devastated. That was the word he used. He was devastated. He was frustrated. His life was about to end because his two rose bushes had Rose Rosette symptoms. Okay? So in perspective, there are scarier things sometimes among your plants than Rose Rosette disease. This was in a nursery this year in New Iberia, Louisiana. If you can look at that picture, smaller picture of just his head, that's blood coming out of the side of his mouth. Okay? We have no idea who or what he had eaten at that point. Okay? And with that, I'm going to stop. And I think we're going to hold questions to the end. Pam, you're up, and I took too long. All right.
Just a real quick introduction here. Thank you, Mark. That was really good. I enjoyed that. Excellent information. And there is a way to manage the roses. He mentioned that I had experience with a garden where we managed fairly effectively. I don't know how much luck was involved, but I take care of the formal rose garden at the Dallas Arboretum. We have about 200 roses in the Rosemary Hager Rose Garden down there. I did not have one case of Rose Rosette disease in that garden this year. We spray heavily with miticides, and we have mechanical barrier around the garden in the form of Nellie R. Stevens hollies, magnolia trees, and last year a big planting of variegated tapioca, which basically walled the entire garden. So by cutting the air circulation down, carrying mites in, and the heavy miticide, we had 100% reduction in rose rosette disease. We had had a few cases in there the previous year. Anyway, our next speaker is Pam Smith. She is in charge of the parks and landscapes for the City of Farmers Branch. She has extensive rose gardens, thousands of roses in Farmers Branch. She has been dealing with this problem, and she's going to talk to us about how she handles the problem on a practical basis right here in the Dallas area. So, Pam, if you'll take it from there.
Thank you. Good morning. As Claude said, I have the privilege of working for the City of Farmers Branch, and sort of got into this rose thing sort of by accident in 2008. Got bitten by the bug. We had tons of roses, and now we have issues. For those of you who do not know, our gardens are located basically at the intersection of 35 and 635, so we're very accessible. We have about 5 acres that we have planted in roses. We have a very large garden that started out as an earth kind garden. We have a smaller garden that was originally a IARS test garden, and then we have a demonstration rose garden over at our historical park. So in 2008, we get into the rose business. This is what we look like. I think this is the best thing since sliced bread. By 2012, we have a garden that looks like this. So you can see we have these structures right here, and now you can't even see them. Our roses are so big. And we did all of this without fertilizer, without pruning them, and with minimal water. And we thought this is the answer to putting color in all of our landscapes. So we were kind of like this Ferris wheel. You know, you had the spring season, it flushed. You had summer, it slowed down. Fall, you got color. Sort of took it easy in the winter. And then we got on this roller coaster. And Rose Rosette entered into our world. I will tell you that the first summer, I don't think I slept. I had to remind myself regularly to breathe. You know, I had come to City Council and told them that this was great, this would be awesome for our city, and now I had a garden that wasn't performing like I thought it was going to perform. So just to sort of go back over what Mark mentioned, what we know is that it's a virus. It's spread by the aphid mite. It has been around for a long time. We are not the first people to experience it. It's very prevalent in the Metroplex, and it's not curable. It challenges that it is a virus, and that viruses mutate readily. And it's not exactly clear if it's localized or it's systemic. And it's teeny tiny, you know, that little dust particle. So it's kind of hard for me to comprehend that I've got this enemy out there when I can't see it. You know, you go out there, there are days in the garden where you don't find any plants infected, and you can almost believe it's going to be okay because you can't see it. But the fact is they're there, they're in the crevices, they're blowing on the wind. Those of you who have been in the Dallas area for a long time, you realize that Chicago may be called the Windy City, but we actually have stronger winds than that. And if it's not blowing out of the south, it'll be blowing out of the north, and it could do both in the same day. And they can hitchhike on other rose pests. The other big challenge is that we've got huge plantings out there that are totally infected. We also have bad information that's being spread. I can't emphasize that enough. To make sure that the information that you're passing on and that you're reading is factual. I think that has set us back tremendously in this area, the bad information that is out there. So those of you that are here today and you're getting good information, please share it. Share it on your Facebook pages. Share it through your next door communications. Call your Parks and Rec Department, and I work for Parks and Rec. I want my residents to help me see things I don't see. If you're living in a city where they're not addressing it, call them. If you're going to a business that you see the rose rosette, let them know. I think that a lot of times people just don't know what's going on, and it's not being vindictive or being careless. They just don't know. So help spread the word. If you have a lawn maintenance company and you have the issue in your yard, help educate that guy when he's coming to your yard. Help them so that when they go to the next person, they can help that person. I think that all of us together, by helping educate those around us, we can make a huge difference out there. But there is some good news. It does not infect the soil. The other good news is roses grow fast. They're economical and they provide great color for the garden. So for me, I had to sit down and say, you know, I would go out and I would buy a tropical hibiscus and I would put it in and I would spend more money on that plant and I would expect it to die at the end of the year. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to keep enjoying my roses. I'm going to practice what I need to be practicing, but it's not going to deter me. When I was interviewed for my job, they asked me what my worst attribute was, and I said it was because I was tenacious. So sometimes I just don't give up, and so I'm not ready to give up on this yet. The other good news is we've got great doctors working on this all over the country. This is not just something those of us in Dallas are trying to fight on our own. We have tremendous support, and we are all working towards the same thing. Then I remind myself that insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. So I had to look at what we had been doing and try to figure out how to do things differently. So we remove everything now that's infected. We did try the crapshoot method, but we weren't slowing it down significantly. We would save a few bushes, but I was afraid that we were probably leaving more, and it was not worth the risk. So we remove everything. Because our guys are working with plants all the time, and we've done such a tremendous job of making sure that we have roses throughout our city, we're asking our guys to wear these Tyvek suits when they're working on the infected roses. Because we don't want the mite to get transferred from planting to planting. So when they get back in their truck, they can just take this Tyvek suit off, throw it in the back, and they can use it the next time they're working on an infected mite. So we're doing that. We're also asking that they do the removal at the end of the day. So rather than going out first thing at 7 o'clock in the morning and covering ourselves with mites and going out and spreading the joy, we're trying to make sure it's the last thing in the day. So in my own garden at home, if I'm going to remove a plant, it's going to be the last thing I do before I go in for the evening. And then we're also putting it in bags and we're disposing it. We also, if we have a planting where we have a huge plant and it's not practical to go get the backhoe to get it out, we will cut it to the ground and then we will chemically treat that stump so that stump does not come back. We're trying to also be a little bit proactive in how we deal with this. This is a picture of Marsh Lane with a huge planting of Archduke Charles. This was taken several years ago before we had any rose rosette issues. You can see it's nice and tall, blooming great. We started getting rose rosette in it. We started off by trying to remove, by pruning, any infected limbs. We would take a flag, put it at the base of the plant. If the symptom reappeared, the plant got immediately pulled out. We found that it was continuing to spread. So now we remove the plant, and then at some point in the fall, we find that we start getting more symptoms showing up. We go in there and we do a hard prune so that hopefully we're removing mites on plants that are not yet showing symptoms. And this is what this planting looked like yesterday, maybe Thursday. I did this program at the last minute. But you can see we're down two rungs, but I still have roses blooming. So we've been able to maintain this hedge, filling in with some new plants, keeping things pruned, being vigilant, watching what's going on, and this is actually an area where we don't do any miticide spraying. It's very difficult to go out and spray a median in the public with insecticides. But we do spray in the big garden. We've been spraying some of your miticides. We're going to spray more of your miticides. We've also done a lot of oils, both mainly because we can get some disease control also with the oils. I'm not a huge fan of spraying, so I'm trying not to do a lot of the spraying. You know, we put in this Earthkind garden because it was a planting that would do well with minimal inputs. But I've also got to protect it, so I'm trying to sort of walk that fine line between using chemicals and trying to use other cultural methods to control things. Education. That's why we're all here. We also are trying to educate our residents. We have on our website a link. If any resident in our area feels like that they've got an issue, I will be more than happy to go out and help them identify the problem and give them advice. We're letting people know why we have gaps in the garden so that they understand what's going on. As I was gathering pictures, I thought this was very appropriate. This is actually one of our roses that's doing well in sympathy. It's just beautiful right now, but I thought it was a good thing for a Rose Rosette lecture. So what now? This is my granddaughter. Sometimes you just have to lower your expectations to avoid unnecessary disappointments. I tend to be optimistic, so I would say that better than lower, what we have to do is we have to change our expectations. This is my yard at home. I've had very little incidents of Rose Rosette, so I'm looking at my yard wondering why I'm not inundated, because I have probably about 125 roses. Now, if you look there, there's a lot more things than roses. So I would say that one of the key differences has to be the diversity. So life is about using the whole box of crayons. Not just roses. There are a lot of things. I think that we're all here as gardeners. So while we want our roses, I think that we can all appreciate the other plant materials and what they add to our landscape. So in the rose garden, one of the things that I found when the Rose Rosette first moved in, man, it hit the rose next to the road, and it hit the roses next to the main aisle. So we have gone in, and the row that's next to the road is now a mixed evergreen planting. We put in dwarf pampas grass instead of the miscanthus. The type A gardener in me has a real hard time letting the miscanthus not be pruned back, but I figured I could get away with doing that on the pampas grass. We also put in things like althea on the end so that we would still have color in our garden in the summer, but it wasn't a rose plant. We put in the Scarlet's Peak holly so that we would have some seasonal color there in the winter with the berries on the end. So we were just trying to diversify that garden. We also added structure to our garden. You know, before I had the roses that were speaking loudest, okay? So now I need to make a garden that's very attractive, and I think this is true of our home gardens. So we put in permanent structures so that when people come visit our garden, it has a sense of age to it. It didn't always look like it was going to be new plants, because right now, my expectations are we are not going to have those massive, huge plants that we had in the Earthkind garden. So I had to figure out a way to make people think that it wasn't a new garden and always on the verge of something. I wanted people to come and feel like it was there where it was supposed to be. We also have included other plants besides roses on our arches. This is an evergreen clematis there. And that's my rabbit catcher. We're incorporating perennial color so that there are other things that for people to look at different times of the year. This is just some of the additional color blooming out in the garden right now. And annual color. So instead of depending on the roses for all that other color, so here we have annuals. And now my garden is actually gorgeous in the middle of the heat of the summer, whereas before, that was pretty much a downtime. So I would say this is a bonus for the garden. Rather than being pure roses, I have a reason for people to come out and take pictures and visit us in August. And being a municipality, it was getting really hard to get people, getting my bosses to think that we were supposed to be replacing all these roses all the time. So we actually host 8 different trials. And by hosting 8 different trials, I have 8 different sources of roses that I am not purchasing. The other good thing about that is when we're looking for roses that are resistant and have possibilities for the future, I think this helps our whole rose growing community because we're willing to take the chance on these roses and see if there's something there. So we have a David Austin trial that probably has about 700 plants in it. Our Arch trial has maybe 80 AGRs, AGRS, probably 40. Conard Pyle sends in a bunch each year, as does Weeks. Certified has a couple in there. We have the miniatures we're trialing. And we've also working with David Zizak out of the University of Minnesota, and we have a trial of species roses. So we've got roses coming in from all over the country in all different stages of introduction to see how they do in this hot spot we call the Metroplex. Now for a garden that is fighting rose rosette every day, I think that this picture says that we're doing something right. This is part of our David Austin trial. It's about ready to burst into full bloom. This is our Jeff Fuller garden, and it is pretty much each of these roses here only stay for 2 years, so that's why they look young. That's the other good thing about trialing roses is that our public has come to expect that every 2 years things are rotating out, so nobody expects to have huge roses there. I believe these are the Conard Pyle. Here are our AGRS trial roses. There's some miniatures in here as well. And then along this fence, we have a huge collection of roses that do well in shade. And talk about being on a wind tunnel. This is our dart rail line right here. So we bring in mites from everywhere. Here's some pictures of our roses that we had blooming this week. The vast majority of these are David Austin roses. You can see how well they're doing with no winter and a good long time to set bloom. So, I would tell you that true happiness is to enjoy the present without anxious dependence upon the future. And when you do that, I think gardening is an absolute joy. So, do the best management practices, but don't get so hung up in the gloom and the doom, because I truly believe that we can continue to enjoy our roses. I think that if you take the pleasure that they offer us each day, as we do with many of the other plants in our garden, that our future is rosy. I don't believe that this is going to shut down our rose growing. I think it's up to us to keep moving forward in a positive way. Take pleasure, share the rose blooms, and help educate your neighbors. There's my contact information. If you're ever in Farmers Branch and you'd like for somebody to walk you through the gardens, give me a holler, and if I'm available, I'm more than happy to go out there and show you what we've got going on.